Neighbors is a rating tool for new and existing buildings. And what we do is we measure the energy performance of buildings using real metering. So it's about how much energy your building's using. And I think the thing that Neighbors does maybe like better than any other rating scheme around the world is that we look at comparing the energy consumption against other buildings in the market. So we take the philosophy that buildings shouldn't stay green just on paper, just on the design stage. We actually want to make sure that the great design for the environment actually happens in practice. If we cannot make that happen, a lot of the benefits of sustainable design actually doesn't happen in practice. So a lot of our work is about how do we make sure that great design really translates to great outcomes for the environment in operations. Neighbors actually has been going on for 25 years, started in the late 90s in Australia. It started in one state, which is the state of New South Wales. You may know it as the state where Sydney is, and expanded to a national program in Australia in about 2000. So it's been a national program for about 22 years. And then over the years, we've actually been working with other countries that have been wanting to take this, the Neighbours philosophy, if you will, in the built environment. So Neighbours has been in New Zealand since 2012. So it's been this year, we're marking 10 years of working with the New Zealand government and the New Zealand industry. And Neighbours has been in the UK for the past 18 months. So it's a much more recent development, but we've been working with many of you and a lot of people in the UK market for maybe 3 or 4 years to actually make this happen.
I have no idea it's been going for that long in Australia, 20 odd years. So this is the first building that we've looked at the reputation. And I think it was only last week that the first building in the UK got an official Neighbours rating, I think down in London. Because we, from the design side, we're looking at designing the building to be Neighbours 5.5-star rating. But as you said, Carlos, you only get the true measure after a certain period of the building being in operation. Can you just explain how that aspect works, please?
Yeah, so we work both with buildings in design and buildings in operation, but the philosophy is very much the same. So if you imagine you were in the early stages of designing a new building, you can actually do modeling, you can gradually you can refine that modeling, you can have a pretty good idea of what you think the building is going to do. But as you know, many things can happen during the construction phase, the early operation phase, and a lot of things can go wrong in buildings, and not only can go wrong, but do go wrong systematically around the world in all countries. People often call this the performance gap, because we are designing buildings to achieve a certain level in when it comes to sustainability and energy efficiency, and the average building never gets anywhere near that. So a lot of what we do in Neighbours is trying to encourage everyone involved in a development, from the designers and construction companies and the building owner, the company that's going to manage the building early on, basically getting all those organizations to work together to make sure that those outcomes really happen in reality, which really is what it takes, right? There's like multiple companies passing this ball along the way. And if you actually want that to get to the end and work really well, everyone sort of have to work towards the same goal. So that's really what we do in design. That is called a design for performance agreement in the UK. And really is designed to make sure that the great buildings just don't stay on great on paper, but they really achieve that in operations. And we also have this other side of the program, which is not just for new buildings. We also have the program for existing buildings, because as you know, for every for every one building that is being developed today, there's probably like hundreds or thousands of existing buildings in the market already that are probably not going to be redeveloped anytime soon, but we really need to work on making sure those buildings become more sustainable. So there's another part of the program that is a Neighbours UK rating, really, that is actually for existing buildings and not just for buildings that are coming in the design pipeline and from not just for new buildings that are becoming existing buildings soon, but also for buildings that have been in the market for decades. So you can get a Neighbours UK rating also for existing buildings in operations. And it works very much the same way. We measure the energy performance, energy consumption of that building. We compare it to others in the market, and then you get a score. And sometimes if you get a low score, a 1 or 2-star score, it means that you probably have lots of opportunities for improvement in that building. And if you improve over time, you might get to 3 and 4 stars, and you can get all the way to 6 stars. So it really is a scheme that is encouraging buildings to improve, regardless of where they are in the life cycle. Every building can become better. And even if a building wasn't designed to be very sustainable, and it's an existing building, and maybe this hasn't been a lot of work for them for a little while, you can still take that building and improve it significantly over the next few years.
Fantastic. So you touched there briefly on sustainability. Ultimately, how big do you think NABAR's impact will be on carbon reduction, Carlos?
I think the impacts on reduction can be very deep. Maybe to give you an example, in Australia, NABARS has been there for a long time. And what it means today is that if you look at a market like the office market in Australia, or maybe also shopping centers, we certify almost every building in those markets almost every year. So if you go to the NABARS website today, for example, you could just go and look at we have a search engine for green buildings where you can see a map of Australia, and you can see all the buildings that were certified in the last 12 months alone. And if you were walking in the city center of a city like Sydney or Melbourne, you would literally be surrounded by buildings that certify the energy performance and the carbon emissions very recently, in the last 12 months. A lot of them have been setting targets for a long time before that, so maybe like 10 or 15 years in a row. And I say all of that just to answer your question, that we actually seen a huge portion of the market moving at a very fast speed. So the average building in the office market in NABARS, the average existing building in the market, saved about like 33%, I believe 33% of energy consumption in the last 10 years alone. So the average building moved at that speed. And the reason why I mentioned that is because that is the speed at which the office market as a whole in Australia is moving. But that's not the speed at which the really fast movers are moving. Like a lot of the organizations that are leading in sustainability in Australia, they've saved energy consumption by about 50, some of them up to 60% in the past decade. And that is both a reflection that a lot of the buildings at the beginning were very inefficient. There were lots of energy efficiency opportunities. So on the one hand, reflects how much more energy buildings can use when we're not really paying attention too much. But on the other hand, once you do, and you are certifying your portfolio, and you're setting targets at the facility level, and the facility managers have targets for energy performance, and you have it in closest with your tenants because they're asking you to improve your NABARS rating, and investors are asking, what's happening with the NABARS rating, so we're improving. Once you have that ecosystem, we actually see companies moving very fast because you get incentives for better performance from all the stakeholders that you work with, from your clients, from investors, from banks that want to give you, green bonds or green loans. And so you can form an ecosystem that creates many, many more drivers for energy performance over time. And that's been maybe like one of the great lessons for me. And when it comes to energy performance, is that every company can create incentives for every company to move on energy efficiency and lowering emissions faster. But often having an indicator like NABARS where you can measure that, you can measure where you are in that journey and how you compare with other buildings, is a really big motivator for more action sooner.
So how early in the design process does NABARS start to have an influence?
So that's a great question. My answer to that is the earlier, the better. I think you can come into a development very late with a NABARS rating, and that can still make an impact. But when you come right at the beginning, it means that it can impact the way the building is designed. Often when you're hitting very high targets if you're aiming for a 4.5, 5-star or a higher target, it requires multiple changes to the way people think. What are the kind of features that you will design in a building? Often we see, for example, a lot of premium developments, you have some decisions to make about how do you define quality, or how do you find even luxury. And one thing that maybe to draw a parallel with another sector with NABARS is in Australia, which is hotels, we're having a conversation about where should we decouple luxury from wastefulness. And one example when it comes to energy is about, if you're running a hotel for 100 rooms, some hotels can go through 1,000 towels in a day for 100 rooms, because they have a towel for everything. So a single person can use 10 towels in a single day. Some of hotels actually do that. That is a real example that that we've seen recently in Australia. And obviously that is an enormous amount of energy consumption just to wash a lot of towels that are barely used every day. So this is a question about, do we need to make some changes to redefine quality? And one of the things we've seen in Australia is that sustainability has actually become a proxy for quality as well. A lot of buildings that are aiming to be very premium or very in landmark points in the city, they're actually looking for, replace some things that were perhaps quite wasteful when it comes to energy consumption with, we're not doing those things because we want to be one of the most sustainable precincts or one of the most sustainable buildings in the world, and kind of using that as a way to drive maybe some changes that are cultural, that are difficult to change. You can replace it by having this new label about, we're making these changes because it's better for the planet. So you have a reason, a deeper reason to do that. I think when it comes to the UK market, there's a couple of interesting things. Every market is different. One example, and I'm sure this has happened to you before, is that in the UK, there are some standard clauses driven by tenants that are very unique to the UK. In particular, many tenants want to run their own central plants. Like, they want to have a portion of the air conditioning and heating equipment on their side of the fence. And I think the challenge with that is that the building owner has to provide a portion of the air conditioning. I don't want to get too technical in this, but a portion of the air conditioning is managed by the owner and the other portion is managed by the tenant, but the whole system, you need both sides for the air conditioning and heating to actually work. So what happens in practice when the tenant is managing that is that the building owner needs to run all the systems all the time, because whenever the tenant chooses to use that, if they want to use it at 3 a.m. on a Tuesday, which is unlikely, but often the leases require the owner to be able to do that if they want that, it means that some systems need to run very inefficiently all the time, just in the odd chance that they might be used at a very unusual time. And I think those kind of things are things that are often cultural or embedded in leases that have been repeated many times. And changing that in leases is difficult, because when you have an anchor tenant that comes in, they have that standard clause, and you need to convince them that they will get a good service, despite the fact that they will have less control, that the owner will manage all that for them. So I think there's a lot of things that redefining, talking about sustainability with something like a NABERS rating can really facilitate some of those discussions. It literally helps the tenants say, hey, we want to be 5-star NABERS UK. To do that, we need to be very efficient. And if we run this central plant very inefficiently, we're going to use 30-40% more energy than when we need to do it. So we're going to make this arrangement that is better for the environment. We know that you care about the environment, and we can provide you a good service. We can guarantee that. May I say first of all, a 5.5 target is an incredibly high target. I think you should be really proud of that. I'm fairly sure that that's the highest target that anyone's set in the Design for Performance scheme, and a 5.5-star NABERS UK rating is incredibly challenging. And I think the fact that you're aiming that high with your first development that you've gone through this process is incredibly encouraging. You should be really proud of that, and we're really proud of what you're doing. And we'd love to learn. You have a little while to go before the building actually gets to operation, so there's going to be lots of lessons along the way. And I think you making efforts like this recording to share your journey is going to be really valuable in for the next year or two as well, for a lot of buildings in the market that want to follow your steps, and maybe they're a little bit behind on the development. Now, when it comes to leases and when it comes to like the market, it's really interesting to see what happens when you have a lot of NABERS ratings being used in the market, because it does actually reach a lot of tenants and it starts changing the way they think. We see a lot of really big tenants, and in particular, big banks, big accounting firms, and the big consulting firms, governments as well. So a lot of the big tenants in the market that have, a little bit of room to think about, how do they procure office space? Like, what spaces are we going to bring our buildings? Can we bring sustainability requirements? Often the tenants that use green leases, like you mentioned, And I think the important thing about NABERS ratings is once people start getting familiar with them, it's actually a really useful indicator to use because a lot of people can understand them. It doesn't, when you use kilowatt hours or per meter square or a more technical unit, carbon emissions per meter square, the amount of people that can understand what that means and what is a high target or a low target is very small. So small that a lot of people that have that can make a difference in setting targets are completely shut out of that conversation. And I think the great thing about having NABERS ratings is that it can very easily be understood by clients that are not very technical, by the lawyers that are working on negotiating a lease or a green lease clauses in those leases, by a lot of policymakers that might be thinking, how do we use, you know, our procurement power? We're renting offices from the private sector. What requirements can we put in? It makes that conversation much easier, the setting targets and the use of targets in these leases. So in the Australian market, we see a lot of banks, a lot of big renters setting, you know, we're only going to stay in office buildings that have a NABERS UK rating or NABERS rating in Australia, and that meet a minimum. And that minimum changes, it depends on the player. Some of them were saying 4 stars about, you know, 10 years ago, and then they raised a few years later to 4.5 stars. A 5-star NABERS rating is often a very common minimum requirement for leasing for a lot of these big players. But that's also partly because so many buildings in the Australian market are getting now into the 5-star zone that you can put that as a minimum requirement for sustainability and still have a lot of confidence that there's lots of buildings that you'll be able to rent from the market. And I do think that's something that we're going to see in the UK as we see a lot of DFP projects coming into operations and a lot of existing buildings beginning to be certified. Suddenly this data that can be used by a lot of players in the market, and I'm really looking forward to that. The only way to get a better NABERS rating is using less energy. That is the only way. You can't put really fancy technology that doesn't reduce energy consumption. That often happens in a building. If that's the case, you're not going to get a better NABERS rating because you need to reduce the real impact of that building on the environment. And so once people have some familiarity with NABERS, they realize that, hey, a building targeting 5.5 stars is using significantly less energy consumption and emissions than the average building in that market. It's actually an incredible achievement. And then once they realize that, they should be rewarding that, or they should be trying to stay in buildings that are, you know, setting those kind of targets. Or maybe they should go to the current owner if you're halfway through a lease and go, I would like you to get a NABERS rating, and I would like us to work together on, you know, how do we go from 2 stars, which is where we are now, can we actually get to 4 stars in the next 2-3 years? And a lot of that requires just exposure to the rating. So a lot of our work here in the UK with our friends at BRE and BBP and is about how do we help the first owners that are starting to certify not just their new developments, but also some of their existing portfolio. Some of them are, not all of them are going to be, you know, 4, 5, 6-star NABERS ratings. And how do we get help them to take that step about disclosing and transparency on all their assets, and how do we help them set targets and start to improve over time? Because that is going to help others to do that. It's going to give more people access and understanding of how NABERS ratings work. And really, we're going to start seeing this dynamic market dynamics of a lot of people using the ratings to create drivers for improvement.
It's interesting because you're right, there can be more CapEx involved to get a higher NABERS rating. But from what you're saying, if there's premium rents and values out there, then that should outweigh that extra CapEx. But one thing that strikes me is that it's obviously a very, very mature market in Australia. And in the UK, we've sort of historically used, you know, BREEAM ratings. We've also got a BREEAM outstanding rating at EDA. But we are seeing a trend that NABERS is perhaps going to be the badge, if you want to call it, for want of a better phrase, on the building that occupiers and investors are going to start to look at. It strikes me that's what's happening in Australia. Do you see that happening in the UK, that really it's going to be about what is the NABERS rating of that building that's going to attract both occupiers and investors?
Yes, I think it's a really good question. And So Australia has, and I love to get into like the relationship between NABERS and NABERS UK and BREEAM, because in Australia we actually have a rating tool that plays a very similar role than BREEAM, and that is called GreenStar, and it's structured very similarly. So they're basically sister rating tools. And in Australia, for a long time, we have to work out, well, how do we actually evolve NABERS and GreenStar in a way that they're complementary and that they support each other? We have definitely achieved that in Australia. So if you are going through a GreenStar rating for design, the GreenStar and BREEAM, the great thing about them is that they can cover so many things across sustainability. And they can constantly evolve to capture like the new wave, the bleeding edge of innovation and sustainability on new development. So it's actually a really important thing that they do. And I think they are complementary to NABERS, because NABERS doesn't cover all things in sustainability. We just cover a small number of areas where the best way to go about them is actually measuring. So we cover energy consumption both in the UK and in Australia. In Australia, we also have NABERS water ratings, another area where you can measure and compare buildings the same with weight. So a couple more rating tools. But the great majority of things in a BREEAM tool, NABERS UK doesn't cover. It doesn't cover it here. It doesn't cover it in Australia. So we've seen a lot of the market leaders using both, using NABERS and using GreenStar. And they use NABERS to go really deep on energy and water. And then they use a GreenStar to go through all the other areas of sustainability that are really important. And they cover, there's like 50 different areas that are covered by a GreenStar tool. So lots of other areas. So it allows owners to go really deep in both. And they're really well integrated in the sense that the energy credits in a GreenStar tool are basically a NABERS rating. So you get a NABERS rating, depending on how high your rating is, that's how you get points. So they're very integrated, it's no duplication. And we're actually working with BRE to achieve the same here in the UK, that BREEAM and NABERS are deeply integrated. That's already happened in with DFP. So you would have seen that in your own development, that you can use a design for performance and your NABERS target within that agreement for the energy credits in BREEAM. We're actually working with them to achieve the same thing with the BREEAM in operation tool. So their energy credits, so people can use a NABERS UK rating to achieve that. So NABERS and GreenStar have become very integrated tools, where the energy credits in GreenStar, both for new buildings and also their GreenStar performance, which is the equivalent of BREEAM in use, NABERS is basically the energy credits on those tools is just a NABERS rating. So they're very, very well integrated. We see most of the leaders in the market using both NABERS and GreenStar at the same time for the same buildings, because they actually help them achieve different things. So they're very complementary. And we do think that is exactly what's going to happen in the UK. We are working with BRE very closely to integrate both design for performance for new buildings in under BREEAM, and also NABERS UK ratings for existing buildings for BREEAM in use, and integrate them directly. And I'm really hopeful that's actually going to help us, join efforts and complement these rating tools, and so we can achieve more together as a market.
Carlos, do you think you'll be bringing NABERS water to the UK as well?
I think it's a possibility that we talked about, and I think the team of at BRE and our partners at BBP, and a lot of people are very interested in that. NABERS West is another thing that we always talk about, and to be honest, there are more things that we hear all the time. Early in the week, we had an event where a few people asked, well, we have some assets in France and in Ireland, could we expand the scheme there? And can we expand this scheme to shopping centers? So there's a lot of, I take a lot of that as a really concrete signs of interest on that this approach for, measuring and comparing that we have in the NABERS UK is valuable for multiple sectors and multiple aspects of sustainability. So I think that's really encouraging. But also I always remember that the most important thing that we have to do in the next 6 to 12 months is actually grow the market in the number of buildings participating in the current NABERS UK scheme. And that's for a lot of reasons, partly because a lot of owners are having the first interaction with the scheme, trying to understand what it takes. How do you design a building that is very efficient? What are some of the things they need to change? How do you do this for maybe your existing portfolio? You know, we're going to start seeing that in the next few months. We have assessors in the Neighbours UK scheme, but all the assessors are new. So they also need a bit of experience on, you know, how do you run these ratings? How do you make the world more streamlined to make sure that the cost of ratings is competitive? And the cost of ratings in Australia is actually very low, but it's because assessors are very experienced. So they have their own systems and they can do things in a very streamlined manner. And that is a really important thing to focus on in the next year, because if we have assessors with experience and owners with experience using the scheme, those opportunities about expanding to water or expanding, allowing buildings in maybe in other countries in the same portfolio, expanding to shopping centers or other building types, all those things become a lot easier once you have a core of participants that understand the scheme and are using them.
Just to sort of go frontline, if you like, a bit into the future with Eden, I mean, from your experience in Australia, what sort of messages do the agents need to be hearing? How quickly did the agents in Australia get up to speed, and how quickly could they in the UK, do you think?
Yeah, so it's a really interesting point, because the UK market is structured a little bit differently than the Australian market when it comes to buildings in operations. You have sometimes a distinction between a facility manager and an operating agent, and we don't. And so often that is the same function in the UK. Sometimes it's two different people. In Australia, it's always the same person. It's just the facility manager. But that kind of tells you how the Australian market is. And the facility management profession has changed drastically in Australia since Neighbours. You'll be hard pressed to find a facility manager, for example, that doesn't have a Neighbours target in the contract. So part of their job is not just managing the asset in the sense of like making sure that the lifts are working, or if somebody complains about the heating being too high or too low, it's actually gone beyond that, and it's gone into part of your role is to actively track the energy performance of this asset. This building was 4 stars last year. You must make sure that it continues to be 4 stars, which means you have an energy budget that you need to look at every week. So facility managers get reports on, you know, you got a Neighbours rating last week. Well, with 1 week into this new year, how are we tracking? Are we on track to achieve that? Do we have opportunities to maybe do a few tweaks and get to the next star rating? Because maybe there's a bonus for you if you actually achieve the next star rating. So energy management has become an integral part of the facility management profession. And we've seen a ton of upskilling as well. By the way, with almost zero training or government programs or grants, it's really happened organically in the market, because the owners really care about their Neighbours ratings. And so they make sure that the facility manager must care about those Neighbours ratings, because that's the easiest way to lose your star rating drop on the scale, is by not looking at your energy consumption and using, you know, 10, 20% more during the year, because maybe something went out of whack and you're running heating at 3 a.m. on a Wednesday. That can happen. That does happen in a lot of buildings. And so that is put such a strong emphasis on management. And that is a fascinating thing to see. You can see it on the recruitment pool for facility management companies. A lot of facility managers who are very young coming into their profession, they are often engineers, which doesn't hardly ever happen in the facility management profession before. Salaries are going up a lot for facility managers because they have more responsibility across more areas. And we've seen maybe like the clearest concrete sign of how that profession has changed in this sense is that the Facility Management Association, which is the industry association in Australia, they're the biggest champions of Neighbours, huge champions. The CEO sits in the Neighbours Steering Committee, is the deputy chair of the Neighbours Steering Committee, and is always going around talking about Neighbours, because it's actually, they've seen the impact that it's had in their profession. They went from being completely out of the loop on the transition to net zero, been kind of like excluded from the conversation, to being literally at the center of the net zero strategy for every major building in the country.